Hello everybody, this is Zaxter99. I want to go ahead and share with you guys a new visual novel, just kind of one I found randomly searching on Itch.io. And this game is supposedly a true-to-life story, non-fictional visual novel created by, I believe it's Xinghua Yang, I believe is how you pronounce his name. And evidently at the age of 18, he had a near-fatal experience and totally transformed him. So it seems pretty good. It is completely free. Guys, you can get this at Itch.io, and I will provide the link in the description as well. So as you see here, I'm logged into Itch.io, and here it is, and it's simply a free download for either Mac or Windows, real short. Probably not a very long visual novel, but we're going to go ahead and play this today. I decided not to live stream this because I typically get a lot of people in live streams like taking away from the experience and things like this and asking questions completely unrelated to what I'm trying to read. Whether it be, hey, what's up with your bearded dragons, or what did you get for Christmas, or when are you going to play Dead by Daylight, or whatever they're asking. Can take away from the experience. So I decided with this playthrough, since it seems to be something pretty serious, I guess, and true to life, I wanted to read this to you guys without any distractions of live stream comments. So we're going to go ahead and get started here on this visual novel about Xinghua Yang, and we're going to start this right after this. All right, welcome back, everybody. I want to go ahead and get this started. I kind of like how it looks like you select begin or end, but if you select begin, it tells you to press Z. I'm guessing Z is for the author's name, Xinghua. So I want to also say that I looked for this visual novel on YouTube to see if there was already 100 people that have played this on YouTube for the main reason, and no matter how I put it in a search in YouTube, I could not find anybody that's actually read this particular novel. What I did find, however, is a video that I'd like to share with you. The link, I haven't even watched it yet, but it relates to this visual novel, and I'll share the link for that as well in the description. But let's go ahead and get started with Loving Life and see what this is all about. The following is a non-fictional story based on my own real-life experiences. Press Z. What is the purpose of life? Life existed for around 2 billion years, but the why of our existence was never answered. Everyone has different views. While the president argues that we need to make a difference, the genetic scientists argue that we must reproduce. An interesting aspect of life is that we are connected to our environment, our world, and from these interactions we are able to consistently change our emotions and modify our thoughts. It's pretty deep. I have discovered only recently that life is a complex and beautiful idea. I remember lying on a bed in a dark and gloomy room, alone, inside a hospital hundreds of miles away from home. The nurse handed me papers to write my will. I thought to myself, what have I really done with my life? Oh, wow. The story begins in the autumn of 2008. My first semester as a freshman at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. It was a chilly day. Halloween was 2 days away. The afternoon sun shone brightly at a steep angle on my face as I walked back to my dorm building after a long lecture of calculus. Wednesdays were always the longest days of the week.
Hey, cheer up a little, will ya?
Who's that? A voice sounded behind me as I stepped into and walked down the hallways to my dorm room. It was Brian, a good friend of mine. Brian was a very interesting man. I almost don't remember how we met or how we became friends, but somehow, within the first couple of weeks into the school year, we connected. We shared many similarities. Both wore glasses, both others called geeks, and both slightly chubby.
All right.
Yeah, I just got out of class, got a midterm tomorrow, I replied.
Ow, I'm sorry, tests in college are significantly harder than high school, I feel like.
I was from Colorado, went to Fairview High School in Boulder. I was involved in rigorous programs such as the International Bachelorette Program and Advanced Placement Program. After experiencing these adventures of education, my brain no longer felt stimulation from these simple entry college courses.
Really? I actually kind of feel the opposite.
Although I attended my secondary schools in Colorado, I was actually born and raised in Harbin, China. I moved to Boulder when I was around 10 years old, without a single word of English. Wow. Life here was tough at first. Back in China, I was awarded the best student in class, best student in the district, and so on. Naturally, I was taught to be extremely competitive.
I can see that coming from China.
So when I first arrived in the U.S., I was looked down upon. Classmates and teachers thought of me as that dumb kid who can't speak or understand anything because of my inability to speak English. Our school did not offer ESL classes, and I was often bullied by others.
Oh, wow.
A student was expelled for attacking me in the hallways only weeks after I arrived in the U.S. However, little changed.
That would be tough to come from a culture like China, a very technologically advanced, sophisticated, and populated country like China with the, it's just a completely different culture. And then coming over and trying to learn English, which we know is one of the hardest languages to understand. There's so many words that are the same or pronounced the same that have completely different meanings. English, they say, is really one of the hardest languages to learn. So to come into the USA from China as a kid, I can imagine that the racism in people and the cruelty of kids nowadays could be really tough. I already feel sorry for this guy.
Well, that's tough, man.
That is tough.
Although hard, I had never given up. I did as I was told. I followed the rules and obeyed life. Eventually, when I reached my high school years, I managed to not only catch up to others, but even surpass them academically, but at a cost. I was tired that day, and unfortunately, I had a midterm the day after. I finished conversing with friends quickly so I could return to my dorm room to study. On the safe side, I kept grades above a 95%, so that there was a buffer zone for my spontaneous laziness. I guess I was losing my competitive edge.
Observe what a mess or study computer science?
Let's observe the mess. Why not? I always felt uncomfortable in my dorm. I never understood why we had to pay so much to live in so little. I had one other roommate, and my room barely had space to fit a bunk bed and two desks. With all the junk on the floor, I had a hard time even squeezing into my study area. As an actual science major, I was required to take a course in computer science. However, one of the options was computer science for non-computer science majors. It turned out to be an easy and useful class and probably one of the best classes I had taken. We covered topics such as HTML, SQL, and even VBA.
In my 2 months here, I had only attended one class, the first class, where the professor said attendance was not necessary and ended his lecture half an hour early. I was able to maintain a 100% in the class thus far. The second midterm was tomorrow, so I guess I'd better start studying. I decided to go to bed unnaturally early that day, at around 11 p.m. Oh, so he's a night owl like me. Are you a night owl up there? Alright. I had somewhat of a nickname of Owl since middle school, partly because I loved owls, but more importantly, because we shared the same sleep schedules. I never exactly took care of my health. I slept when I felt tired, and I ate when I felt hungry. I was fine, though. I was still young. After rolling around in my bed for half an hour, followed by the interruption of my roommate slamming our room door coming in, I finally fell asleep. I had a recurring dream that night, the same dream I always had when I had a fever growing up. A nightmare that I could not escape. Okay, wow. What the heck is that? Looks like a dream. I stood in the middle of endless grass, green and luscious. The horizon was light blue, with beautiful sunlight shining through. The nearby sky, however, was covered by dark, thick smoke high in the sky. There was a loud humming noise, like a refrigerator with an amplifier. I felt the ground and my heart shiver in its rhythm. Dang. In front of me was a machine, large and black. It was likely the source of the humming sound, and possibly the source of the smoke in the sky. I wasn't sure. The machine was tall, I would say about 4 to 5 times my own height, and it was about 3 meters away from me. It looked like a very tall computer, but it could also pass as a smaller sized factory considering how there were gears and pipes coming out of it. I stood completely motionless, but you could feel its inner operations, mysterious and unknown. The most interesting part, however, had to be the white speck on the left side of the machine. On the left side of this very dark, very large factory computer machine, there was a small animal, a bunny, sitting in pure white. The bunny did not move either. It only stared back at me with soulless eyes, an expression which cried for help, silently. Oh, see the little bunny here. That's odd. Kind of seems like a dream. The bunny looked so powerless and so innocent and so pure. The world was in complete quiescence. In quiescence, if you don't know what that means like nothing's happening. It's kind of dull, you know, there's not anything going on. So the world was in complete quiescence except for the sound from the machine. Only the machine, the bunny, and I existed. This feeling translated to absolute horror in the consciousness of my mind, unsure why. Is this dream some kind of foreshadowing of what's to come? Looking at the bunny and the machine, sometimes I almost feel like I was looking at a mirror, an image of myself. Oh, what the heck? So blood? Gotta be blood. Suddenly, I started choking and felt a large stream of liquid gushing into my nose. I had been too familiar with this feeling. A bloody nose? Yep, my nose started bleeding. Oh no. I quickly applied pressure to my nose and sat up, jumped down from the top bunk, grabbed a couple of tissues, and ran into the community bathroom just a few steps outside my room. Although I had no chance to look at the clock, I was certain that I hadn't had much sleep. I did what I usually do when I have a spontaneous nosebleed like this, wash my face with cold water, then get a large ball of tissue and stuff it in the nostril. However, this time was different. Copious amounts of blood splattered everywhere, almost as continuously pouring out of my nose in a stream. I knew I was in for a rough night. Oh wow. Z, oh damn, you're having a nosebleed again. Is it bad? A friend walked in seeing me stuffing my nose with tissue paper. My name is Zhenghua Yang. I never used an English name to go with my Chinese heritage. A good friend of mine from high school, tired of trying to figure out how to pronounce my name correctly, resorted to calling me Z. Since then, it started to catch on. Eventually, it became the norm, or became the name or letter that I would be referred to by. Okay, so somebody can't pronounce his name correctly, and everybody starts calling him Z. I can totally see that. Yeah, I guess pretty annoying too, because I have a test tomorrow, I replied. Well, who's this guy? Do you need my help? I can loan you my notes. No, it's okay. I just want some sleep, actually. My friend, Shikank, was from India. You know, I found that people from India are always really friendly. It seems like they're really, really friendly people. I have no idea how you pronounce his name. Shikank, I guess? I don't know. Anyway, I always found it amazing that he spoke English so fluently, even though he came to the U.S. only a few months ago. I guess this discussion could go on into how the Western civilization advancements led to the age of exploration. But I'm not in the mood. My nose was bleeding. So he asked if he can lend me his notes. I'm going to just put some tissue and try to get back to sleep, I told him as I walked out, stuffing my nose with more tissue. Are you sure about that? You should tell me your roommate. You should tell your roommate about it in case something goes wrong. He's already sleeping. It's all right. Shikank looked at me with a grunt of dissatisfaction. He walked out of the bathroom and passed by the commons area on my way back. Seemed like many people on our floor were still awake. So he comes into the community bathroom, sees his friend with a massive nosebleed, stuffing all kinds of tissue into his nose to try to stop the blood. And he says, hey, you have a roommate. So obviously, these guys are paired up in two-man dorms. So he's like, you should tell your roommate about your nosebleed in case something goes wrong. And Zhenghua was like, no, he's my roommate's already asleep. So that's why Shikank gave him a grunt of dissatisfaction. And then he asks, that spot in your face, is that something wrong too? What spot? Shikank pointed at a spot on the left side of my face. I felt it and noticed it was bleeding slowly. Oh my god. This guy has a massive nosebleed now, bleeding on his left side of his face? On his cheek or something? Wow. Oh no, that's just a pimple. We're teenagers and this is common. Observe the commons area or ask, what are you guys up to? I guess I'll observe again. I love this place. I lived in an international dorm full of foreign students. I picked this dorm because I thought I would make friends with a diverse group of people, and it was a great choice. Unlike most dorm halls, it was the middle of our floor and a small commons area. It really helped us to get to know each other well, and our entire floor was close because of that. Okay, and now I'll ask what he is up to. And he says, we're studying for a midterm tomorrow. What about talking about guitars? I overheard their conversation earlier. Shikank was definitely talking about guitar chords. In fact, I was sure he was playing Hotel California just seconds ago. Oh, I love that song. The Eagles, Hotel California, masterpiece. Yeah, well, we're taking a small break. Shikank was a kind and gentle soul. He always treated others with respect and kindness, something I couldn't understand. He was always very positive about community service, again, something I couldn't understand at all. I believed in social Darwinism, survival of the fittest. If you're sickly and aren't educated, then you deserve to lose. Why waste time helping those who are unfit to stay alive? Why waste your valuable time, Shikank, upon the people who aren't fortunate enough to keep ahead of the race? Sure, it sure was ironic thinking back on it now. I walked back into my room. grabbed my box of tissues, and climbed up the bed again, trying to sleep. My nose, however, did not stop bleeding. I resorted to sleeping minutes at a time, followed by choking on blood and changing of tissues. Several hours passed while I tried to sleep with a bloody nose, and half a tissue box later, blood was still pouring out. Oh my God, that is not good. Yeah, nosebleed should stop within, you know, I don't know, a half hour or something like that. I mean, if you're still bleeding, if you have a nosebleed that continues and continues and continues, especially if it's just pouring out, still after like half an hour, much less several hours, yeah, it's time to go in to get emergency help. Wow. I had never really been healthy. In fact, I had been fairly unhealthy. I guess that was the price I paid for my achievements. I had been hospitalized several times in my life, many of which I no longer remember. The sun rose. I skipped my midterm that morning. I assume blood gushing out of my nose was a valid excuse. You think? The blood still had not stopped. Unsure if I was delusional from the lack of sleep or just the blood loss, I stayed in and ate random foods we had around the dorm room, mostly ramen. Oh my God. Before I knew it, it was already noon. I heard Brian coming back from class a few rooms down, so I strolled over. Hey Brian, what's up?
Holy cow, you're still bleeding? I didn't think it would last this long.
Yeah, I thought I'd save money on my Halloween costume this year and go with the Bleeding Man. Oh my gosh, being funny.
Well, I do give you credit for being comical under the intense circumstances, but we're going to the health center right now. Come on.
It's actually getting better. I don't have to change tissues nearly as frequently. I think it's going to stop soon.
Nope. We're going to see a doctor. The medical center is like a 5-minute walk. Come on, let's go.
Fine, but seriously though, it's slowing down a lot.
Well, I'm happy for you.
He dragged me out of the dorm and out of the building, and we made our way to the health center a block away from our dorm. Brian is an excellent friend. He has a great sense of responsibility, self-control, and he exercises them with a touch of humorous sarcasm. I only recently witnessed the beauty of his character. One night a few weeks ago, we were studying in the commons area. Okay. Brian and a few others, including myself, decided to order some pizza sticks to fight against hunger, while a few others said they had dinner and refused. Brian collected the money and made the order. Minutes later, the delivery boy arrived with a large box of pizza sticks. Being in the center area of a college dorm, this created commotion. Many of our friends gathered around, and we were bombarded with their pleas. I can imagine that. I've been in the Navy, so I know how this goes. I know how it goes when you're in the Navy and you order a pizza, especially, or something like that. Everybody bombards you with your requests. Hey, let me have a piece or whatever. Yeah, it's pretty crazy. Everybody's suddenly your friend. Yep.
Oh, can I have one? I didn't have dinner tonight. Wow, that smells nice. I'm just going to take one and head out if that's okay.
The number of people was increasing. Before everyone started tearing our box apart, Brian stood up on top of a chair and yelled as loud as he could.
Hey, stop!
He made a huge fuss.
Guys, I'm really sorry for being the douchebag here, but obviously we don't have enough for everyone. And I think it's only fair for people who actually paid for it to get a piece, or get any at all.
Well, good for him. Good for him. Otherwise, half your pizza would be gone to people that didn't even pay for it. I mean, you pretty much got to do that. You got to stand up for yourself, especially like if you're, you know, I imagine in a college. I never went to college like that, but I was in the Navy for 7 years, and so I know exactly where he's coming from.
But I'm just going to take one slice, though, okay? Just a bite. Come on, man,
said a friend of ours who already picked up a piece of pizza.
No, seriously, you can't do that.
Brian chuckled a little as he said it, probably out of nervousness.
Only people who paid can have it. No one else can.
You can have one of my pizzas, said a friend of ours who paid for the pizza sticks to the friend who didn't.
Nope, sorry. I think you're totally missing the point here. You can't do that, Brian immediately replied.
Again, good for him. Brian made a huge scene. He looked and probably felt like a selfish prick and an ass to his friends. However, his act struck me because he did something I had not the bravery to do. I had lived life with the assumption that my goal was to contribute and generate happiness for others. I never stood up for myself. I never spoke up when I felt like I needed to, and I rarely considered what would make me happy. Brian's actions, although addressing a trivial topic, inspired me on an astronomical level. That's cool. Because the pizza sticks belong to all of us, we all paid for it. So if you give yours away, then you'd be giving all of ours away. I spoke up, explaining the situation. So he kind of defends his friend Brian there. So he probably would never have done that if he hadn't seen his friend Brian speak up, though. I like that.
I have no idea what you mean, but okay, whatever. It's just pizza sticks.
Her words made me feel silly. It was true. They were just pizza sticks. But I felt that that was not the point here. People did not speak further after hearing the comment. People did not speak any further after hearing my comment and went on with their own activities. We all then ate our pizza sticks in silence, knowing that although it seemed we acted selfishly, we were able to establish some order, maintain our integrity, and satisfy the growling in our stomachs. It was clear I was not the only one thankful for Brian's actions. Why couldn't I be more like Brian, being able to stand up for myself and for others? Well, that wouldn't be me, I guess. My role is to stay quiet and fit in with others, right?
Your face doesn't look as red, Brian commented.
Walking made me feel better and distracted my mind away from staring at the red ink leaking down from my face. We walked past the trees and stepped into the entrance, approaching the front desk.
Oh, so you're in for a bleeding nose?
The nurse, well, receptionist perhaps, asked me after taking a glance at me. She wasn't exactly in the mood to work. Yeah.
How long have you had this nosebleed?
I looked down at my watch. Around 13, 14 hours? Oh my gosh. The nurse turned her head up and stared at me in disbelief.
Wow, that long? You know you're supposed to get medical attention if a nosebleed lasts for like more than 15 or 20 minutes?
Yeah, well, not really. Now I do, I guess.
Alright, fill up this form and then have a seat.
The waiting room was crowded. We found a couple of seats in a far corner. There were a couple of familiar faces here, people from my classes, so I acted as I should as a shy Asian kid and kept to myself. Aww. Observe the girl from class sitting across from me.
Sure.
A girl from my class was sitting across from me. Looked like she had a stuffy nose. We sat next to each other in class every day, probably because she was always late and had no other choice. That's kind of sad. He thinks that the girl only sits by him because she had no other choice because she was always walking in the last minute. Wow. I remember learning about Socrates, the great philosopher, and how he enjoyed walking down the streets of Athens, engaging in conversations with strangers. I thought about how fun it would be to open up and freely talk to people.
Oh God, she just looked at me. Look away, Z, look away. Avoid all eye contact.
Huh. Man, he is shy. Alright, let's observe the fraternity guy. I didn't understand why people would join fraternities. What was the point of spending so much money on college to learn, only to spend more money to prevent yourself from learning? To me, brotherhood meant nothing but a waste of time. All I needed was to get good grades and graduate early. Why? Well, I never really thought about that, but it was what most successful people did, right? Alright, last one is recall. I was here once before. Okay. I was here once before for free bottles of Advil. Our monstrous tuition covered weekly free bottles of Advil. Shikank dragged me here to get them,
and then we sent them to countries in Africa where pain medications were scarce. Oh, that's cool. I wonder if those pills actually helped someone. I would like to think so. I guess it was kind of, made me feel better, knowing that I helped someone out there somewhere. After waiting a long time, we were called in. So you had this nosebleed for 14 hours? Said the doctor with a heavy Asian accent. That's really quite a long time. You're supposed to get medical attention if a nosebleed lasts longer than 15 to 20 minutes. Yeah, I heard. Well, let's take a look. The doctor walked closer to me and pulled out the tissue in my nostril with a larger tissue. To my surprise, the nosebleed had stopped. Not a single drop of blood. Perhaps the walking helped. So I asked him, do you know why this happened? Well, a couple of things. Blood usually needs platelets to clog properly. Platelets are these small cell fragments that flow in your bloodstream along with the other cells. The purpose of platelets is to stop bleeding when it happens. I'm sure you learned that in biology classes. Yeah, I have, but so there's something wrong with my platelets? Yeah, this is not normal. Normally, nosebleed should not last longer than 15 to 20 minutes. This could be a case of blood platelet deficiency, resulting in blood not clotting properly, he said while smiling in a creepy, creepy smile. Have you had any red dots or rashes on your skin recently? A couple of weeks ago, I had a cluster of red dash on the side of my elbow. That was most likely what we call purpura, which means clusters of blood vessels bleeding. I'm going to assess your physical abilities real fast to see if there's any bleeding in the brain, because that's the most dangerous. Oh, wow. That'd be scary. Yep, this scared me. Looking at Brian, it seemed like he was scared too. All right, I stood up. I was instructed to perform silly movements around the room, and I nailed the test. Wonderful news. I was not bleeding in my brain. Yeah, that is definitely good news. Everything looks good. I'm going to reschedule for you to come in tomorrow morning and do a checkup to make sure everything was okay. For tonight, though, really make sure you don't do anything physical, because if you're still at a dangerous level, we want you to stay safe. Try not to move around too much. Stay in as much as possible. All right, I can do that. Okay then, before you leave though, take this and go downstairs and get your blood drawn. He handed me a note for a lab test. I cursed in the back of my head. I hated needles. Haven't I lost enough blood today already? So I ask him, right now? And I almost moan. The doctor looked at me confused. Yeah, right now. After having my blood drawn, we headed back to the dorms in time for dinner. I thanked Brian for seeing me to the medical center, and then headed late to class. I walked back into my dorm room to find my roommate gone. Realizing I left my phone in my room, just then I picked it up to call my mom, thinking she might be interested in an update. I saw 23 missed calls, all of them from my mom. Now that definitely sounds like a mother, right? I needed to call home more. I had not been in touch with my parents recently, at least not as much as my mom would have liked. I came from a very loving family, and with love came overprotection. My mom had always been worried about me when I was away, and for me to go to college had been her worst nightmare. She required me to call home every couple of days, which I followed at first. However, for one reason or another, I lagged once and again. This time around, I had not called for weeks. There wasn't much need to talk to my parents, really. They were all good and well there, and I was all good and well here. I love my parents dearly. I now regret my actions at the time. If I had called home more frequently, maybe this whole ordeal never would have happened. She was especially frustrated when I delivered news about my nosebleed. She told me that being an irresponsible vegetarian may increase the pH levels of the blood, and sometimes that might lead to my autoimmune illnesses and other unwanted changes to the blood composition. I told her what the doctor told me, and she planned to research the platelet issues and will call me back later. The conversation closed with her telling me to stay safe and other things moms would say to their sons.
I love you, honey.
Huh. 8 o'clock that night, my cell phone rang. Hello?
Hi, this is from the health center. Am I speaking to Mr. Yang?
Yeah.
We have received the blood test from earlier today. I need to warn you that you are in a very serious condition right now. The blood report shows that you have a blood platelet of 23,000 per liter of blood. The normal range for this number is 137,000 to 383,000. Anything below 137 would be considered as in danger, and anything below 50 should be considered life-threatening.
Oh, wow. Anything below 50,000 per liter is considered life-threatening, and he's at 23,000. Oh my god, that'd be scary. Stunned, my brain was empty. I did not know what to think. My numbers were clear and made a huge emotional impact. I was, at this moment, not even half the life-threatening level.
This is obviously a very critical situation. Are you bleeding anywhere at the moment? Do you feel any pain anywhere? Any dizziness, nausea, or fatigue?
I did not know how to react. I had to retrace what I heard to be able to answer the question.
No, nothing like that. Okay. We do have an appointment scheduled for you tomorrow morning at 11:20 a.m. to check and see if your condition worsens. You need to make sure not to have any physical activity at all tonight because you are in danger right now. If you start bleeding anywhere at all, even from a paper cut, you will need to call us or dial 911 for medical attention.
Oh my god, could you imagine a doctor or nurse calling you and saying this news that you're in a life-threatening situation, and if you start bleeding even from a paper cut, you need to call 911 because you're in that much danger? That would be scary as hell. Oh my god, this poor kid. And remember guys, this is a true story. This really happened to the developer of this visual novel. This is not just made up.
Okay, sure, I said half-heartedly, thoughts racing in the background of my mind.
Oh my. Half an hour passed as I sat motionless in front of my desk. How did this happen? What did I do wrong? What will happen because of this? Is something bad going to happen to me? Why don't I feel sick at all? And am I going to die? That'd be the scariest thought that I think most people in that situation would be racing to. I mean, if it was me and I was called at 8 o'clock at night and I was told I was in a life-threatening situation, there is no way I'd be able to sleep. And I'd be wanting to go in right now. I wouldn't be wanting to be waiting another, 15 hours or whatever until 11 o'clock the next morning. That would be awful. The fact was, this illness was odd. I would not feel anything different from before. However, I noticed the pimple on my face again. It really was not just a pimple. I turned my head to look in the mirror. The spot on my face was bleeding still, since days ago, constantly, and the skin under it looked pitch black. This was probably a sign of my low platelet count. I should really have paid more attention. Suddenly, a sense of depression fell upon me. I felt so powerless and so meaningless. It all happened so fast. Just yesterday, I was playing frisbee with friends out on the field. I was confused, unable to really accept reality. I took the least amount of physical movement possible that night, knowing that I may bleed elsewhere just as easily. I had a simple dinner and went to bed early, keeping in mind that I had to go back to the medical center tomorrow morning. And that night, I slept like a log. Well, that's good. Oh wow. The alarm clock. The alarm clock called me for about 3 hours before my appointment. Punctuality had been one of my strengths,
whether for friends, family, or personal reasons. I once had an argument with Brian because I planned to leave for class 15 minutes earlier than he did. I guess being too early might mean that I was not punctual after all. I turned on my laptop and opened a packet of cereal, mixed it with some milk, and gobbled it down while watching some Japanese anime show. Over the years, I developed a habit of eating while watching something, mostly TV shows. My mom told me that it was a very bad habit, and it would waste me more time eating if I ate normally. I kind of agreed, but I just kept doing it. I felt this way, I would not be wasting time while eating. With a click of a mouse, I started recording myself in front of the computer. Since college started, I had been keeping a video journal about my daily life, much like people do on YouTube. I kept them private, though. The video journals were meant to record just how I grew and changed under such a different environment. First time away from home, I never knew at the time just how valuable these short clips would become in my life. Today is October 31st, Friday, and it's Halloween, and I'm kind of dying. 2 days ago, I had a nosebleed for 14 hours, from 1 a.m. to 3 p.m. I went to the health center, and they stopped it. They did a blood test, and apparently I have an extremely low platelets in my blood, which means if I get a cut right now, it will not heal, and I will probably bleed to death, any kind of small cut. So, this morning I have an appointment at 11:20. Right now it's 11:06. I'm going to go see my doctor right now. Just checking in to see how I'm doing. It's not that good. And that's about it. See you later. That's cool that he records a video journal of himself, kind of like a diary. The hallway was filled with Halloween decorations and costumes, fake spiderwebs, ugly face paint, annoying pumpkins, and scarecrows. Straw from the scarecrows was scattered all over the floor. It had been an aroma of negativity for me annually. I had a tradition of ending up in the hospital on this day every year. In the 7th grade, I was in the hospital for severe pneumonia on Halloween. In the 8th grade, I broke my left wrist on Halloween. I wore a cast for 4 months. And as time went on, the list went on. Another addition to that list today. Well, that'd be a good reason to hate Halloween, wouldn't it? For every year, you're always hospitalized. The health center was filled with worthless Halloween decorations as well. The employees had made their point that no one aimed to work today. Greeted by the bumblebee receptionist, I was directed to another blood draw. Oh, great. I called my mom while waiting for the doctor. I spoke Chinese, like we did at home. I told her about my 23,000 platelet level. And she told me that I had, I told her about my 23,000 platelet level, and she told me that I had had bleeding issues growing up as well, something I never knew. She also insisted on coming over from Colorado along with my dad and visiting me to make sure I was okay. The nurse called me to go inside. I hurried in after saying bye to my mom. I met with a different doctor. A large man in a shiny fairy costume with what I hoped were fake breasts. With rainbow glitter and a golden crown, he was quite a traumatizing sight to witness. Oh, don't mind me, I'm the Halloween fairy. The office wanted to do a fairy-themed Halloween this year. Oh, I see. Yesterday afternoon, you came in to a bleeding nose, which lasted 14 hours, am I correct? Yeah. Do you have any other symptoms of bleeding since then? Over the night or this morning? No, I didn't. Alright, well yesterday you were at 23,000 platelets. Today you're at 20,000 platelets. He pulled out the paperwork and glanced at it. That shows clear indication of dropping, which is not good. I'm going to write your files up and you should get someone to drive you over to the hospital. Once you go there, go to emergency and hand them this file. They'll take care of everything for you. His words scared me. I had no idea how to react. A sinking feeling of despair hit. I'm getting worse? I have to go to the hospital? The emergency room as well? What about my tests, schoolwork, education in general? So I asked him, I have to go today? He looked at me confused. Now, actually, right now. I have a test coming up. I was actually planning to do some studying. The doctor laughed really hard and then he replied, believe me, school tests are the least of your concerns right now. I paused a little. With my envelope of information, I stepped out and called my only friend with a car, Thaddeus. He helped me and my friends by driving us to the local Walmart from time to time. He was deeply religious, and I really appreciated his presence on my dorm floor. Yeah, that friend with a car is always handy. I kind of experienced that in the Navy as well. People with cars were kind of rare when we were first going to school in the Navy. I called him and he picked up. Hey Z, how's it going? Hey Thaddeus, I said weakly. I might need your help. Alright, what's up? Have you heard about my recent sick thing? Yeah, She King told me. He pretty much told everyone by now, I think. How are you feeling? Are you okay? Apparently I'm not actually okay. I'm at the medical center right now, and the doctor told me I need to go to the hospital and go to the emergency. Oh no, that's really bad. Are you okay right now? Do you need me to, give... Oh no, that's really bad. Are you okay right now? Do you need me to give you a ride? Yeah, that's why I'm calling. I kind of need a ride, and you're the only person I know who has a car. Alright, no problem. I'll come over in a few minutes. Do you need anything else? I can bring you some stuff if you need. No, it's alright. Thanks so much. I really appreciate this. No problem at all. I'll be there in a few minutes. Sit tight. I was naturally polite to Thaddeus because he was polite in general. I felt that his politeness pushed people away, alienating himself from others. Maybe I was wrong. Perhaps I felt that way because I was usually mean and insensitive, someone with obnoxious or insolent humor around my friends. Maybe that's why Thaddeus and I never became the best of friends. We had different views on how to live life and how to treat people. I always had the feeling that people who are polite are just pretending to be nice, and that secretly, all people are evil and selfish in nature. Just like the Bible said, we're all born sinners. Oh my. Thaddeus arrived promptly, along with Chick Hank and Brian. Hey guys, Thaddeus, thank you so much for this. I really do appreciate it, I said as I entered the car. My friends greeted me with warmth. Yeah, sure, no problem. There's Brian. Yeah, there's Brian. Yeah, sure, no problem. And, Shikang says, how you feeling? He asked hastily. I'm not really alright, I don't think. I really can't say. I'm not too sure about what's going on here. You need to be careful. Are you alright? Do you feel okay? Yeah, I feel okay. I was mostly scared and overwhelmed. I was glad that Thaddeus knew the exact location of the hospital. I had always been poor in my directional sense. Whenever I went anywhere, I always made sure I brought a friend. If I didn't, I would be lost no matter how familiar I was with the area. My dependence on others had always been a hindrance in life. Whether they were my parents or my friends, I never understood how people started their own businesses in high school, or how people traveled the world by themselves as kids. I guess I never really took charge or had real direction in life. I chose conformity and anonymity throughout my teenage years, and I never questioned that choice. Rushed into the emergency room, I handed the nurse my large envelope of documents and was told to wait. I was pleasantly surprised when a nurse called me in just minutes later, only soon to be unpleasantly surprised when a large group of doctors and nurses started observing me. That'd be scary. Doctors and nurses alike hurried. Yeah, that would be scary. Doctors and nurses alike hurried left and right around me, and before I realized that the room was packed with lab coats, all eyes upon me. Mr. Yang? An old, bald doctor initiated the conversation, staring intensely at the papers in his hands, most likely the papers in the envelope. Yes?
We must proceed to examine your conditions immediately. You are currently in critical danger.
Yeah, the platelets decreased since yesterday by 3,000.
Yes, he paused for a second. Excuse me, did you say by 3,000?
Yeah.
Oh, no, I'm sorry you've been mistaken. Yesterday you were at 23,000 platelet count. Am I correct?
Yeah.
Right now you're at 2,000 total. Oh my gosh.
What?
Right now you're at 2,000 total. See this number here? That's in thousands. He pointed to a number on the paper. It said 2. Next in the normal range, 137 to 383.
Oh my god, could you imagine that? You're supposed to be at 137,000 to 383,000, and this guy's at 2,000 platelets. And remember, the critical danger level was 50,000. Anything below 50,000, this guy's at 2,000. That would be scary as crap.
Did the doctor at the health center say you was at 20,000?
Yeah, wait, so it's only 2,000 right now, total?
Yes, sir. This is the number from yesterday. He pointed to another number on a different sheet of paper. 23. Your platelets have dropped 21,000 within half a day's time. Having 2,000 platelets is extremely dangerous, and we must place you under immediate care. For comfort and reassurance, I looked over at my friends, and they had their eyes wide open.
They're scared. They're scared for their friend. Wow.
Man, that's scary. I wasn't able to comprehend what had happened just yet. They put me in a wheelchair, and I was rolled into an exam room as the group of lab coats followed. All of them had notebooks open and pen in hand. They were taking notes as they walked, and they never stopped staring at me. They were probably MD students. This is a severe case of ITP, which stands for idiopathic thrombocytopenic. Wait a minute. This is a severe case of ITP, which stands for idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura. The cause of the illness is usually unknown, but most likely due to an immune system malfunction. Some symptoms include large spontaneous bruises all over the body.
So it sounds like this doctor is talking to all the, you know, the people taking notes and trying to learn.
Check. I had around 11.
Yeah, so check. I had around 11. Each one larger than my palm. Again, probably another signal that I should have paid attention to.
Damn. Large clusters of red dots on the body. Seemingly like a rash, but if you press on it, they stay red.
Check. A rash on my arm from a week ago. Definitely not due to the dry weather.
Muscle ache and our other internal organs not healing.
Check. My muscles had been aching incrementally ever since I worked out a week ago. I could barely get out of my bed sometimes due to the pain. How was it that I never made the connection?
Have you recently had any colds or the flu?
I had a cold a couple of weeks ago.
That may have been the cause, for instance. What about any family history of illness, HIV or HIV-related illnesses?
No, not that I know of. My mom used to have extended nosebleeds when she was young, and so have I.
What's the frequency of your nosebleeds, and how long do they last?
The students stared at me with their notebooks in hand as I was able to share with them the answers. The students stared at me with their notebooks in hand as if I was able to share with them the answers on their upcoming test. About once a week on average as I was growing up, and they're usually around half an hour or longer. They look down and jot down the answer, awaiting response from the leading physician. Yeah, having a nosebleed once a week that lasts 30 minutes or longer, that's crazy, dude.
Yeah, this is what the doctor says too. Yeah, this is way too frequent. From the time you've given, it would support the fact that you might have had ITP all your life, which would make the case chronic. Do you know nosebleed should last no longer than 15 minutes?
Yeah, I'm well aware.
So tell me about the medical history of your family.
Well, my parents... Before I finished, I felt something way too familiar. Again,
Oh no, more blood? My nose spontaneously burst out with blood, splattering everywhere. The nurses and students were amazed and whispered amongst themselves upon the sight. The doctors took steps back to avoid the blood splatter. And then a couple of nurses rushed in with a plastic nose clamp for my nose to prevent further bleeding. Without any time for me to respond, they already started rolling my bed out the door.
We're going to have to take an ultrasound and a CT scan to see in detail if there is any bleeding inside your body, the doctor stated, as more of a command than a suggestion.
Hold on. I held out my hand to pause them. Chick Hank, here, take my cell phone. I shoved my cell phone into Chick Hank's hands. Call my mom and tell her what's going on. Immediately afterwards, I was rolled outside the door. Oh wow, this is not good. The tests were painful. I was unsure at that point as to why, perhaps a combination of my aching and my emotional hopelessness. Slowly, while lying on the machine, life started to fade away. My stomach repulsed and my head muffled. The world darkened and then faded out of view. Oh no. It was cold. Oh wow. What the heck? I was freezing and I was knee-deep in the snow. The snow reminded me of my hometown in Harbin during the coldest days of the year. Snow was pouring down densely, making it hard to see, but the air was calm. There was no wind. The sky was dark and gray, and it was hard to see with the snow. I was rolling my father, who for some reason was in a wheelchair, towards a small wooden cabin around 80 yards away. The cabin looked lifeless and dead. I frequently had dreams about my father being in a wheelchair, even though in terms of physique he was probably healthier than me, so this was not surprising. As I approached the cabin, I saw figures moving inside of it. From their movements, I could tell they were my paternal grandparents, and with excitement, I rushed in with my father. Inside, it was cold, dark, and gloomy, with odd-colored lighting. Both my grandpa and my grandma were pale, and also in wheelchairs. I ran up to them and hugged them, crying about how much I miss them. I hadn't seen my grandparents for many years. I knew my grandfather had lung cancer, so we couldn't talk over the phone. Both my father and I cried with them, but their bodies felt cold. My grandma asked me if I was doing well and said that as long as I was happy, life was worth living. I told her that I was doing fine and that I was very happy. My grandpa did not speak. He only smiled. Same kind and gentle smile he displays every time we meet. My grandma stopped talking shortly after and just sat there, also smiling. Wow, he's like having a... like an almost out-of-life experience, it sounds like, with his grandparents or something. He's dying. It sounds like. The world blurred once more. The colors faded fast. My entire body felt cold, especially my jaw. I woke up finding the nurse stuffing ice into my mouth to keep me hydrated. I said hi to her and inquired about my blackout, and she explained it was due to low blood pressure, but everything was fine now. Little did I know that, at this exact moment, my grandfather went into the final stage of cancer and passed away shortly on the other side of the world. My healthy grandmother followed him weeks later due to an unexplained heart failure. Wow, that is sad. So his grandfather passed away, and then his grandmother, who was healthy, died
of a heart failure just a couple weeks later. And I've noticed that in life, that a lot of times, you know, married people that are married like their whole life and that have a long, loving, you know, companionship, when one of them goes, the other one's health like fades really quickly. It's kind of sad, but I've seen that happen too many times in my life, like with friends and their grandparents and different things. That's really sad because your love is so strong that once you lose that, you know, that's such strong partner in your life that it's hard to go on without them. It's really kind of a sad reality that exists all too often, it seems like. I was only told years later because my parents wanted to ease my pain. Aww. I love my grandparents very much, and may they rest in peace. Aww, this is sad. I was rolled into a hospital room. My friends were there waiting for me, and they looked relieved to see me. I just now noticed the different machines I was now attached to. Are you alright? Shekank asked me. Yeah, I'm fine. Sorry to see that you guys are still waiting here. It's fine. Stop. Stop saying things like that, Shekank replied as the nurse settled me into the bed. Do you want something to eat? It's dinner time. Yeah, I could eat. Alright, we'll go get you something and bring you back here. What would you like? Anything's fine. My friends left to get food after giving my cell phone back to me. I was about to make a call when a nurse came into the room with some paperwork in her hands.
Mr. Yang?
Yeah?
Here's the paperwork for you to fill out for your will.
Will? Will what? I thought to myself, not understanding her words. I continued to stare at her, waiting for her to finish. Noticing our disconnect, she started explaining again.
Have you heard of a will?
She tried to be sensitive. I finally understood her words, but I did not understand what she meant.
Yeah? Has a doctor come in to tell you?
I haven't seen anyone come in. The nurse opened her eyes wide, possibly realizing the cause of the disconnect we had been having. She stood still for a second, and then she continued.
Well, as you know, right now you have around 2,000 platelets.
She spoke very slowly and softly, trying to make no mistakes.
Usually, by hospital procedure, anything below 5,000 to 10,000 platelets would be considered fatal.
I continued to stare at her blankly.
With such low platelets like that, and the severity of your illness, there's not much we could do.
She took a large pause. Oh no.
We have tried our best, but were unable to quickly raise your platelet counts due to the seriousness of your illness. The antibodies in your blood make the effect of transfusion slow, if they even work at all. Your bruises indicate that you should be expecting several severe internal bleedings in the near future, most fatal being inside your brain.
Wait, am I going to die? I wanted to cut to the chase.
We've done the best we can, Mr. Yang.
Oh my god, this is terrible. Now remember guys, this is not fictional. This actually happened to this guy. I mean, this is a true story. This really happened. It makes it, to me, that makes us so much more sad. Wow, where's his parents? Am I gonna die? I wanted to cut to the chase. I chuckled a little. There was a long pause in our conversation, and then she started again.
The doctor had said that you will have maybe a few more hours to finish your will and your dinner.
Oh my god, only a few hours to live? Oh wow. I remained motionless.
After a while,
the nurse walked out saying,
if you need anything, let me know. I understand this may be hard to take in. I'll be right outside.
Oh man, this is tough.
I looked down at the paper she had handed me. Last will and testament of, and then you fill in the blanks, be it known this day that I blank of blank, being of legal age and sound, and disposing mind and memory, and not acting under duress, menace, fraud, and blah blah blah, it's the will. Last will. Only then, after reading these words, did I fully understand the situation. I was going to die, and I only had a few hours left to live. Tears started dripping from my eyes. However, it was not because I wanted to live longer. Manny continues to read the will. I look back on the 18 short years of my life. Yeah, that's way too young, people. I look back on the 18 short years of my life and thought about what I did with my life. I saw the most beautiful pictures, the most fantastic moments. Continues to read the freaking will about payment of debts and burial costs. Man, I remember that when my father left China in 1996, he hugged me and cried and promised me that he would work really hard so that both my mom and I would also move to the U.S. and live together here once again. I remember how 4 years later, he kept his promise, saving his money every day of those years, and only the one goal of reuniting our family together. That sounds like a good father. It sounds like a very loving father. He was lucky there. 18, though, too young. Continues reading the will, where your property's going, who it goes to. Could you imagine how hard that would be to fill out a will in the moments knowing that you only have hours to live? And you have to sit here and figure out every piece of property that you have, where it's going, who you're going to give it to, the relationship to you, who's going to cover the cost of your burial and your, and you know, man, this would be tough. I remembered my middle years of school. I struggled so much because of my inability to speak English. However, I always had friends who looked out for me. I worked hard in school and hard outside of school to catch up to others. In 2004, I was not only elected to be the president of the Boulder Amateur Radio Club Juniors, I also was selected to give a speech to hundreds of people in Dayton, Ohio on the topic of amateur radio and cultural acceptance. After practicing for the speech for months, I made no mistakes and I made the auditorium go wild. Not only have I learned to embrace my cultural heritage, I had also grown to love public speaking. That is really cool. I remembered my high school years. The transition was tough, but I bore with it joy. Although I was introverted, I always had great friends who cared and guided me every step of the way. I lost my own identity, and together with my friends, we built new ones for ourselves. Going through IB and AP classes, participating in clubs, or just playing cards outside of the library, I always had people who loved me, people who cared for me, no matter what. Continuing to read over and fill up the will. I remembered the handful of weeks I had been in college. Being a foreigner, I knew no one. However, in the short amount of time, I was embraced by friends who supported me and appreciated me for who I was, no matter how introverted or cynical I could be sometimes. People whom I had connected with here, Brian, Chick Hank, Thaddeus, and many others, had been so caring and so loving of me. Oh my God, and then he signs it. I cried, not because I wanted to live longer. I cried because I then realized how painful it must have been for people in my life who loved me. I considered my family, my friends, and all of whom had given me everything. In the short 18 years I was allowed, what had I done to give something back to them? What had I done to deserve all of their love of me? Man, this is putting tears in my eyes, guys. This is really, really sad. This is cool. I mean, especially that this is real. You know, this really... Wow. Oh, my. People always say life is short, so make the most of it. And they are right.
life is a very complex idea. I don't know the meaning of life or why we're here. However, I've learned that life can truly be fragile and that you must make every single second count. I had lived a life in a secluded manner, pessimistic, cynical, introverted, and unsociable, were only a few of the terms that described me. Truth is, I never took the time to look back on my life and appreciate all the opportunities I had been given. Grades aren't everything. People are not determined solely by a number or a letter on paper. Being shy only hurt my chances in life. Drowning myself in Japanese cartoons or video games adds no value to personal growth. After 18 long years and looking how life had treated me, what did I have to present to give back to the world?
Damn, that'd be bad to be in that situation to start feeling guilty about how you think everybody's loved you and given you so much, but you've given nothing back to anybody. That would be an awful feeling. I did not want to abandon my family, my friends, and all the people who loved me, leaving them with only grief and sorrow. I wanted to continue living for everyone and spread happiness among them all. So I did. A few days later, I returned to Colorado with my parents and have been recovering here since. No one could explain just why I did not die. In that one fateful night, the doctors were certainly amazed. My illness was later determined to be the first one case on current medical record, even with modern medicine, that nothing worked. After 2 long years of hospitalization, I decided to return home. Miraculously, once I stopped all the experimental medications, my condition improved significantly. And in the spring of 2011, I had recovered enough to go back to school, this time as a student of finance and economics at the University of Colorado in Boulder. That is amazing. Wow. And I reminisce on the moment when I sat in that gloomy hospital room thinking about my past. Now I think about my future and what my illness has taught me. I set myself to no longer be the introverted, timid, and pessimistic person who I was, and instead become a friendly, outgoing, and positive icon for happiness. If Brian was able to take a stand for his friends over pizza sticks, then so can I. I am no longer the bystander, silently observing others, fantasizing about what could happen. Now, I take actions to pursue my dreams and give back to others my newfound hope. That is so cool. Every day of my life counts. I have become a beacon of happiness, bravery, and success. My proudest achievement thus far must be Serenity Forge, a video game development team I started once I returned to Colorado. I turned a valueless hobby into valuable experiences and goals. I always had the dream of developing video games, pushing the medium into the realms of art. Now, together with all my friends and colleagues here in Serenity Forge, I can achieve just that. I know that life is beautiful, and that I am lucky to be alive. I was given a second chance. Every second of our lives is an adventure which we must embrace. I love my life, and I will give my all to make the most of it, for myself and for all those who love me back. Wow. That is so cool that he actually made it through that. I mean, when they're telling him he has hours to live, he needs to fill out his will, and he's sitting there thinking about his life and feeling guilty for not giving back to the people who have loved him and cared for him so much. This is amazing. Wow. Do not make the same mistakes I did. Do not wait until your second chance to truly appreciate the people around you. Go out there and tackle the world with your head held high. Only then will you be living to your fullest potential as the beautiful person that you are, and as the amazing person that life deserves. Wow, I like that. All right, I guess that's the end of it, guys. Yeah, credits. Right here.
Greetings, this is Z. I am the developer and the producer
of
this
visual
novel game. Thank you so much for playing through the story and supporting the Serenity Forge video game development team. This story was in fact a true story, even down to the details of the dreams I had at the time. This all happened about 4 years ago for me, and I am now 22 years old, going to school at Boulder, Colorado. I would like to take this time to thank some of my friends and colleagues who not only made this possible, but also supported me every step of the way during my illness. I've always wanted to share my story somehow, and this all started when I had the realization that a visual novel program for the computer would be fun to produce and would be the perfect medium for me to tell my story. With no programming knowledge and no digital art knowledge, I went ahead and dove right into development. I drew all of the art, wrote the script, and programmed the entire game myself. I even made the font after my own handwriting. But of course, I wouldn't have done it without all of the help from my friends. Writing can be tedious sometimes, especially when you write alone. Here are some of my friends who helped me edit the script of the story. Thank you all so much for your help. Special thanks to Carrie and Taylor. You both helped me tremendously in your edits, and you're really the reason for the script being so polished in the end. I started this project with no programming knowledge. I wanted to thank my friend Norris for not only helping me with my dumb programming issues, but also consistently being inspirational whenever I program. Most importantly, as you have noticed, the music in this game was phenomenal. And that's because the music was composed by several friends of mine who are professional musicians. John Spring was used during the flashback sequence about the pizza sticks. Paxson's variations on the word hope was used for the final scene in the hospital room and the sunrise backdrop. Taylor's Somnium was played during the two dream sequences. And now most importantly, the main composer of the game and the lead game designer for our development team on other projects, David Foreman. Out of the 11 songs in the game, he composed 8 of them, and 7 of them are fully polished songs lasting several minutes long. I won't go into the details on individual songs, but they are all amazing, especially the final credits music he composed, which you're listening to right now. Thank you so much for all of your help. I could not have done this without you, Dave. If you enjoyed the music, you can find the fully downloadable original soundtrack of the game on our website. Go check it out and give some support to these wonderful musicians. This experience truly changed my life. Looking back at how fragile life was, I learned to make every second count. I really wanted to share my experience with others, so that people my age would realize how precious life is and how easily it could slip away. Thank you once again for supporting me and the Serenity Forge video game development team. I hope you enjoyed the experience. I know I have. Definitely look forward to our future projects as well. I guarantee you that they'll actually be playable games from here on out. Thanks again.
All right, guys, I want to go ahead and say this visual novel here was really amazing. I mean, it was short, it was to the point, and it really has a great, great message about, you know, not taking life for granted. Make every second count. Make sure those that love you and care for you are given back, you know, your love and your attention, so that you're not feeling guilty when your final moment happens. Life can be short, and it can unexpectedly end on a dime. Oh, wow. Okay, look at this.
I dedicate this game to my friend, Victor. For the past few years, he had trouble finding meaning in and appreciating his life. As his friend, I wanted to show him my experience in order to facilitate his path to self-identity. Victor passed away 2 days before I finished this game. Oh my gosh. Wow. So after everything he went through, losing his grandparents, while he was going through his epidemic, then making this game, he lost his best friend, Victor Lee. Rest in peace, my dear friend. The beauty of your character shall never be forgotten. 91 through 2012. Only 19 years old, 20 years old? That is sad. Damn. This was really, really good. I can't believe that I found this visual novel without ever hearing about it. With just picking it up, randomly on Itch.io, looking for a visual novel to play. I want to go ahead and share this, guys, with you as well. This here is on YouTube when I search for Loving Life. Zengua Gang here. I couldn't find anybody playing this game, but I found this little video here. Let's take a look at this, guys. A quick look at the start of it anyway. I'll have the link to this YouTube video down below. This is the actual guy, the developer. Everything that happened to the guy here, he's right here. Let's take a listen to this.
Yesterday, I spent 3 hours hanging out with some of my best friends, whom I haven't seen for years. And today, with only 3 hours of time, I accomplished a major goal in my life, and I feel absolutely amazing. Well, what did I do? Well, I'm a gamer, and I play around 3 hours of League of Legends every day. Video games define our world. They have played a huge role in my life, and I would not be here today without them. When I was 18 years old, I was diagnosed with a severe and chronic blood disorder that caused me to bleed if I made even the smallest muscle movements. I dropped out of school and was hospitalized. I was told that I would not survive longer than a few days, maybe weeks. These were two of the most difficult years I've ever had, not because I was in pain or because treatment was difficult. It was hard because I had lost all hope of accomplishing anything in life. I had lost contact with all of my friends. I had people who later told me that they thought I was dead. My family suffered alongside me. My parents didn't know what to do or how to make me feel better. We all lived with the constant fear that I could die at any moment. Through these 2 years, through my loneliness and despair, I turned to the only thing that gave me meaning in life, and that was playing video games. I started playing all sorts of games, such as the online multiplayer game League of Legends. With over 10,000 hours logged in these games, I made friends from all around the world. These internet friends of mine didn't even speak English. However, they would check up on me every day to making sure that I've been taking my medicine.
All right, guys, with that, I'm not going to play his whole video on, my video here. I just wanted to go ahead and show you guys a couple of minutes of this video here. But I'll have the link to this YouTube video that he made about how video games saved his life and how they can save yours as well. A great speech by this developer and the guy that this happened to. So check out that link as well if you want to hear all of that. I'll also provide the link to the Itch.io site where I happen to luckily come across this great visual novel. I'll have a link to that as well. I want to thank you guys for being here with me. Hopefully you guys found this visual novel, a real life, true story, as inspiring as I did. And hopefully from this, may all of us understand just how short life can be and how that it can end at any given moment. Don't take life for granted. Make sure each and every day you hug somebody you love. Make sure they know, without a doubt, that you love them. Life is short. And the odds of you being here, you, yes you, the odds of each of us being here, alive, is miraculous. It's 1 in 10 billion that you're even here.
Don't take advantage of that. Don't take that for granted. Use your life to spread joy and happiness and love to other people. Go out and make somebody smile today. This has been Zaxter99. Take care, everybody. We'll see you in another video or live stream right here soon. Love you guys. Take care.